Today on News Center, Career Services held a workshop to inform students about internships, hear about MSU's jazz ensemble, and take me out to the ball game. MSU softball held its first home game of the season. All this and more today on News Center.
Good evening and welcome to News Center. Thanks for joining us. I'm Holly McClurkin.
And I'm Damon Huff. Here's what's making headlines for March 16th, 2017.
Dr. Joseph A. Morgan has been offered a contract to succeed Dr. Wayne Andrews and become Morehead State's 14th president. Paul C. Goodpaster, the chair of MSU's Board of Regents, was authorized to extend the offer during its quarterly meeting on March 9th after an executive session. Currently, Dr. Morgan serves as the Chief Academic Officer and Vice President for Academic Affairs and Student Success for the Kentucky Council on Post-Secondary Education. Dr. Morgan was the finalist in the search for the university's next president, and if he accepts the contract, will in fact become the university's 14th president. And the new dining facility located near Alumni Tower is nearing completion and has finally been named. After the Morehead State University's Board of Regents gathered on March 9th, the dining facility's new name, the Rocky Adkins Dining Commons, was approved. Representative Adkins is a two-time MSU graduate and is well known for his love and enthusiasm for his alma mater and has been inducted into the MSU Alumni Hall of Fame. Representative Adkins has been helpful in getting state funding for the Space Science Center, the Center for Health Education and Research, the renovation and expansion of ADUC, as well as many other expansions and upgrades to buildings and residence halls on campus. When the new dining facility opens, it will be informally known as The Rock.
Former Morehead State University men's basketball coach Sean Woods had a hearing in Vandenberg Superior Court in Evansville, Indiana on Monday for a misdemeanor charge of battery resulting in bodily harm. Woods resigned in December of 2016 following a suspension from November after two Morehead players told MSU police they had been assaulted during an away game by Woods. MSU PD contacted the Evansville police after speaking with the two players. According to the court clerk, the magistrate ordered a six-month diversion. All charges against Woods will be dropped if he stays out of trouble over the next 6 months. He was also ordered by the judge to pay $1,080 in court costs and restitution.
Dr. John Ernst has been named by Morehead State University as the new interim dean of the Caudill College of Arts, Humanities, and Social Sciences. Dr. Ernst succeeds Dr. M. Scott McBride, who was named Chancellor and Chief Academic Officer at Penn State DeBow. Ernst has served as Associate Vice President for Academic Affairs and Student Success since July 2016. With his background, Dr. Ernst is unique. Stephen M. Ralston, MSU's Chief Academic Officer and Provost. In his past positions, Dr. Ernst worked successfully on many high-priority institutional initiatives. I'm confident that he will provide outstanding leadership in this new role. Ernst, a Louisville native, earned his doctoral degree from the University of Kentucky and first came to MSU in 1994 as a fixed-term instructor of history after serving 3 years on the staff of the Kentucky Encyclopedia. He was the recipient of the Master Teacher Award given by the Interfraternity Council, National Panhellenic Conference, and National Panhellenic Council in 2001, and was presented the Student Government Association Student Choice Award for Faculty Member of the Year in 2013.
President Donald Trump plans to hold a political rally next Monday at Freedom Hall in Louisville. According to the Courier-Journal, President Trump's visit comes just days after Vice President Mike Pence visited the state to talk about the administration's plan to repeal and replace the Affordable Care Act. With Trump's planned visit to Kentucky comes plans to protest the rally. The protest rally is being organized by Indivisible Kentucky, a self-described grassroots progressive movement in the state. Indivisible Kentucky spokesperson Chris Rousey says the main focus of the protest will be the GOP health care plan. The event is slated to start at 4:30 p.m. More news on Trump. Hawaii federal judge Derek Watson put President Trump's revised travel ban on hold. The judge issued his ruling Wednesday after hearing Hawaii's request for a temporary restraining order involving the ban. His ruling blocks the executive order from going into effect Thursday. More than half a dozen states are attempting to stop the ban, and federal courts in Maryland, Washington State, and Hawaii heard arguments regarding the ban on Wednesday. The state of Hawaii argued that the ban discriminates based on nationality and would prevent Hawaii residents from receiving visits from family in the six countries mentioned in the ban. The state also says the ban would negatively affect the tourism industry and the recruiting of foreign students and workers.
Morehead State University has partnered with international nonprofit Enactus to host a challenge to all residence halls on campus. The Lights Out Challenge encourages students to turn their lights out, unplug chargers, and regulate their heat and air to conserve energy across campus. The initiative began Monday, February 20th, and runs through Friday, March 17th. Morehead Housing and Enactus will measure the energy output of each dorm at the end of the challenge and determine the winner by which had the least output. That dorm will win a pizza party for all of its residents, so remember to turn out those lights when you leave for class.
With the recent adoption of Kentucky's right to work law, Round County Judge Executive Walter Blevins hopes it will pay off for his county. Blevins, when speaking with MSPR, admitted he didn't support the measure as it began moving through the legislature, but notes that several economic development experts have told him that having a right-to-work law will create a lot of jobs for Kentucky. He hopes that means some good things for the MMRC Industrial Park. A right-to-work law prohibits businesses and companies from forcing their workers to join unions as terms of their employment. Career Services held a workshop to inform students on internships and express their importance. News Center reporter Jacob Valerio attended the event in order to learn more.
So today we're doing an internships basic workshop, and this is intended for any student, but particularly students who are at the early end of their college career, looking ahead to the next 2-3 years, learning how they can build the experience that they need to be marketable after graduation. And what that means for most students is an internship. Now we refer a lot here at the Career Center to experiential education. That can include internships, clinicals, student teaching, practicums, and so forth. But the internship in particular is what we're going to talk about today. It's, again, all about getting the experience in the field that a student needs so that they can market themselves on their resume when they get to the finish line and be competitive in the market. We hope so, and I tell you, the presentation I'm giving today, it's all based on the most recent data that we in Career Services collect with regard to why internships are so critical, why employers are expecting them. We're at the rate now where above 95% of employers expect to see it on a resume. And yet we know that nationally only about 65% of students are doing the internships. So if you want to be competitive, you need to be in the bunch that are pursuing these sorts of opportunities while they're still in college. So we're going to talk about all the data. And again, it's as fresh as data can be, the facts and figures I'm going to be going over with students today. At the Career Fair, over a third of the organizations that joined us are offering internships. So this is the time, particularly for sophomores who still have their junior and their senior year ahead of them, this is the time to strategically begin to think, what internship opportunities are right for me? How can I have been applying for them? And also, very importantly, how can I get academic credit for internships? When I was in college, and that's been a while since I was a student, but in my time, I was under the misconception that if I were to pursue an internship, it would take me away from the critical task of being a student and getting the credits that I need to move towards graduation. Well, the game has changed. And fortunately for our students, be it through their home department or be it even through a course that we offer, MSU 339, students can get the credits that they need to continue towards graduation while they're pursuing their internship. We'll talk about that today as well.
After the break, Ricky Nelson has your weather forecast for the week, and we'll be back with this week's New Center Spotlight.
It never gets old, huh?
Nope.
It kind of makes you wanna
break into song?
Yup. I love the sunset.
I love Eagle Lake.
I love the forest.
I love when eagles play.
I love the campus!
And all its lights and sounds.
Boom-de-yada, 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 boom-de-yada.
I love philosophy.
We love diversity.
I love English.
And all its weird words.
I love the music.
And all its melodies.
Boom-de-yada, boom-de-yada.
Boom-de-yada, boom-de-yada.
I love fraternities.
I love sororities.
I love to draw things.
And all the athletes.
I love Morehead.
It's such a pretty place.
Addison, why are you dressed up like that?
Because you're in a dream, John.
How can you prove that?
Your body's still there.
What?
Wake up and smell the coffee. Java City.
Hello, I'm Eric Thomas, director of the Star Theater here at Morehead State University, and I'd like to invite you to come out and join us for some of the great programs we offer in the Star Theater. Our programs are both educational, with planetarium programs, and entertaining, with laser shows that feature artists such as Elton John all the way out to Metallica. So come join us at the Star Theater, located in the Space Science Center here on the campus of Morehead State University. And if you've got questions, go online to moreheadstate.edu/startheater.
Good evening. I'm Ricky Nelson bringing you your weekly weather forecast. Right now, it's a little chilly with 41 degrees and sunny. The wind makes it feel like it's a bit cooler, around 36 degrees. Moving on to our record temperatures, on this day, the record high in 1932 was 84 degrees. The record low in 1993 was 1 degree. The normal high for around this time is 57 degrees. The normal low is around 34 degrees. So we're closer to the normal low around this time of year than we are to the normal high. Moving on to our live Doppler radar, courtesy of WKYT. As you can see, we have some rain and storm moving in from the northwest down over here to Morehead. So we'll be seeing a little bit of rain and a little bit of storms next week, but they should pass very, very quickly. On to our temperature map, also courtesy of WKYT. Over here in Louisville, around 42 degrees, Frankfort 41, and Lexington 39 degrees. Over here closer to where we are, Mount Sterling, it's about 39 degrees. In Morehead, currently 37, Ashland 40 degrees. So it's been a little cooler this week than it was last week, but don't worry, the temperatures are going to get warmer. On to tonight's forecast, it's going to be mostly clear with a low of 26 degrees and 0% precipitation. We've had a little break from the rain, but it won't last very long. Tomorrow's forecast, it's going to be rainy with a high of 45 degrees. The sunrise is at 7:41 a.m., so we had a little break from the rain these past couple of days, and it's going to rain again, and then we'll move on and get another little break from it as the temperatures rise and increase. Now let's move on to our 7-day weather forecast. Friday, it's going to rain with a high of 50 degrees. You'll see showers all day. Saturday, it's going to be 46, partly sunny with a 30% chance of precipitation. Now, on Sunday and Monday, it's going to be up in the 60s. It's going to get a little warmer and the rain is going to go away. So we'll get a break from the rain, we'll get a break from the wind, and we'll get the sun out and we'll get the warm temperatures that everybody wants for the spring. Tuesday, the temperature is going to drop back down a little bit and we'll see thunderstorms in the morning. Wednesday, it's going to be partly sunny, 54. Then Thursday, the temperatures are going to climb back up into the 60s. The sun is going to come back out. We're going to get rid of the rain, and we're going to get that warm weather that everyone has been so excited for the spring.
I'm definitely excited for that warm weather.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to the sun being out and it being warmer.
Well, thank you, Ricky. Now let's send it over to Damon Huff with this week's News Center Spotlight.
Morehead State University's School of Music, Theater, and Dance performed the Jazz Ensemble's concert at Baird Hall. News Center's Hannah Hardwick was there to show you more about the Jazz Ensemble.
The Jazz Ensemble's concert was performed at the Duncan Recital Hall on March 9, 2017. The Jazz Ensemble was broken into two groups. The first group to perform was the Jazz Ensemble 2, which was directed by Professor Matthew Giger. And the second group to perform was the Jazz Ensemble 1, directed by Professor Ryan McGillicuddy. News Center caught up with bass player Mason Doherty to learn more about the Jazz Ensemble and exactly what inspired him to join the Jazz Ensemble and his love for jazz music.
Started playing a bass guitar about 10 years ago, and then last year when I came in here as a freshman, I started really diving into playing upright bass. And I've just loved music all my life and have grown to love jazz. and the jazz ensemble has been a great outlet for me, and as well as many others, to play this art form, this very American art form for everyone. It's very distinct, and it's a whole lot of fun. I just really enjoy being in the jazz ensemble. First off, it's a big band style, and so we have 4 to 5 trumpets, 5 saxophones, 4 trombones, and then a rhythm section with a guitar, a piano or a marimba, a bass, which what I do, and drums. And it's a very particular style where it's a lot of the charts are written out rather than opposed to some small jazz combo styles where there's a lot more improvisation. But it's very style driven, and there's a very particular way that we have to play many of our pieces, like accents on interesting parts and like playing with swing as opposed to not playing with swing, or playing a rock beat or a samba beat, and it's pretty cool stuff.
Be sure to catch the next event, the Air Force Band Concert, at 7 p.m. tonight at Button Auditorium. And when we come back, Brian McGee will have your Eagle Athletics update.
Lord, what fools these mortals be.
Romeo, Romeo, wherefore art thou, Romeo?
I have always depended on the kindness of strangers.
Hey. Yeah, you smell that sweet smell.
Like jerky and diesel.
Hey guys, just sitting out of sweat.
You got this, you own it.
You give him a paycheck every other week. You know why? You're its boss.
Spread your wings, you magnificent eagle.
You don't worry about a thing. I suck that right up.
Rack it, rack it.
Woo, yeah. Glip, 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 glip.
It's so majestic, I think I'm gonna cry.
Morehead State softball made their way home for the first time this season as they played a doubleheader against the Radford Highlanders on Friday, March 10th. The first game started with Ellen Barra hitting a home run and driving in 3 runs, giving the Eagles the early lead. In the second inning, Radford would try to rally back in the third and would cut the lead to just 1 with Hunter Mundy hitting a single and driving in 2. However, Morehead's Robin Layton would answer with the long ball in the fourth inning and would hit a solo home run, increasing their lead 4-2. From there on, the Eagles' pitching would take over. The Eagles would close the game by starting pitcher Chelsea McManaway, gaining her 6th win of the year, getting a complete game, only allowing 3 hits and striking out 12 Radford batters. The Eagles would win 4-2. Eagles would stay hot going into the second game of the day, when in the third, the Eagles would score 3 runs, with 2 of those being off the bat of Robin Layton, when she hit her 8th home run of the year. The Eagles would again score in the fourth and go up 4-0. But Radford wouldn't go away easily. Radford would score 1 in the 6th and get 2 more runs off a home run in the top of the 7th. But the Eagles would shut the door on a comeback as Allison Rager would get her first save of the year and allow the Eagles to come away with the 4-3 win and sweep. Coach David Williams spoke about where his team is at as they get prepared to enter conference play in the next few weeks.
Very happy we're competing. We're finding ways to manufacture runs. We're finding ways to win games. A lot of it's coming via the long ball right now. We've got a lot of timely big hits, home runs that are happening at the right time, but our team is very much in a competitive spirit and has the right mentality as far as competing with teams and knowing that they can win. I knew we'd have some home run potential this year. I guess the frequency and the timeliness of it, that's unpredictable. You know, people hitting them at the right moment. Some of that might just be luck, but we do have a lot of long ball potential with our lineup this year, and that is something that we talked about prior to the start of the season. So we're really trying to stress the productiveness of our offense at this point, and really I think that now that they can see that we can do things in many different ways, and we get solid defense behind our pitching, we can compete with a lot of people. We're just trying to find a type of rhythm that we can establish, an order. And I think as we go through the next couple of weeks before we hit conference play, we're going to continue to try to tweak that, play with that a little bit, and hopefully get that rhythm that we need and find the order that's going to be successful for us. And
the Lady Eagles will be participating in the first round of their first appearance in the Women's National Invitation Tournament tonight at 9:30 p.m. Eastern Time. It will be an away game with Middle Tennessee State playing at home. Middle Tennessee State comes from Conference USA and has a 21-10 record going into the game. Lady Eagles have a similar record of 21-9. Both teams finished second in their respective conference. If the Eagles win, they will face the winner of tonight's Bethune-Cookman-Wake Forest game. The Kentucky High School Basketball Hall of Fame will be inducting two of Moorhead's own. It was announced on Tuesday that Greg Todd and Harold Sargent are among the final 18 members of its centennial class to be inducted. Greg Todd is Moorhead's current women's basketball coach and has led the Lady Eagles to their first national invitation tournament in the program's history. Harold Sargent is a former men's basketball player. He was named first team all Ohio Valley Conference three times, and his jersey number 50 is retired and hanging in Johnson Arena. The induction will take place on July 22nd at the State Theater in Elizabethtown. Stay tuned. After the break, we'll take a look at the Cicero Society hosted debate and more.
Connecting you with employers and graduate program. Get info to launch your career now. Turning you into a professional. Focus on professional development. Start your job or internship now. Let Career Services help you separate yourself from the crowd. Develop into an expert candidate. Career Services is here to help. Build a network. Hands-on workshop. Career Services, turning you into a professional.
Yo, why you looking at bags, bro? What you need is a chick magnet. You put me in your room and boom, chicks. That's what I'm talking about.
Cicero Society hosted a liberalism versus conservatism debate in Raider Hall on Tuesday. News Center was there and talked to Max Proent, one of the moderators, about the debate.
So I try my best to be as objective as possible in there, but I am certainly right-leaning. I'm on Tyler's side. And so my intrinsic reason was to sort of demonstrate to people that conservatism actually is an intellectual ideology, right? Or not ideology, a collection of philosophies. It's not inherently racist. It's not inherently sort of try to keep people in the Stone Age against progress, if you will. So that was one reason. Another reason was I was hoping that this debate could explore intelligent things. What I mean by that, if you see the Hillary Clinton-Donald Trump debate, that was not intelligent. It was yelling. It was spouting out pre-written zingers, right? And I think that we saw in there that it wasn't. We had two individuals demonstrating that we can have people of totally opposing ideologies have a decent conversation where people can learn. I think both of the sides in there, left and right, sort of refined their arguments and also maybe learned a thing or two. I see people really concerned with social issues, and I think that's sort of natural, right? People, right? Aristotle says people are naturally political, meaning we naturally are going to intermingle with one another. We care about the well-being of each other, about ourselves as well. And I think based on the questions, we asked what, like 5 or 6 questions from the audience, I think almost all of them had a hint of, what do you think about these people? What does the Constitution have to do with these folks? How do we sort of ensure equality? Things of that nature. So yeah, I think now, as almost always, people are going to be concerned about social change and social issues. So because it was only an hour and a half, we wanted to do a sort of superficial survey of some of the major topics, right? Foreign relations, constitutionalism, things of that nature. I would have liked for us to go to delve deeper in almost all of them. I guess the idea is if we wanted to expand conversation is to have as many of these events as we possibly can, right, without them becoming just sort of redundant. And this is our first semester, and I think we're off to a good start, but next semester I'd like to see things like maybe 2 or 3 panels, right, another large debate, things of that nature.
Yesterday, the 2017 recipients of the Blakeman Memorial Scholarship were announced by Morehead State's Office of Alumni Relations and Development. Adam Caskey, a biomedical sciences and pre-med major and former programming for Sigma Phi Epsilon, Cole Huff, an accounting major and SIGEP's vice president of finance, and Logan Donathan, another accounting major and currently vice president of programming for SIGEP, are the 3 recipients. The scholarship was established in 2012 in honor of Jeffrey Scott J.B. Blakeman after his death in 2011. Blakeman was a member of Sigma Phi Epsilon and a Chi Omega Big Brother. He graduated MSU with an industrial technology degree, was a member of the Eagle Trace Men's Golf Association, and an avid outdoorsman and a proud supporter of Round County and Morehead State Athletics. To apply for the scholarship, students must submit an application and include a statement listing past involvement and contribution to their chapter, campus, and community. To learn more about the application, contact MSU's Office of Alumni Relations and Development at 606-783-2033.
March is Disabilities Awareness Month, and a Morehead agency is working to create greater awareness about the issue of intellectual disabilities. Leanne Creech is the Executive Director for DNS Community Services. She spoke with MSPR and says estimates say about 38% of all Americans deal with some form of intellectual disability. Despite those problems, she says those individuals are often very productive members of society. Creech notes that the nearly 50 clients DNS assists in the Morehead area performed about 500 hours of service to the community last year.
A public health program designed to limit transmission of infectious diseases in Round County begins March 21st. These harm reduction programs focus on limiting the risks and harms associated with unsafe drug use. A state-funded trailer will be on site starting at 2 p.m. and will be providing 2 free doses of Narcan to anyone in need. Narcan is an opiate antidote that blocks effects of opioids and can reverse overdoses. Bobby Ratliff, director of the Gateway District Health Department, says that the program will be open weekly on Tuesdays from 2 p.m. until 4 p.m. That's something we can extend if the demand is there, he said. In other communities that utilize this program, it has taken a little while to have the users and addicts learn to trust you. The program will be completely anonymous. Participants will be given an ID card to present each visit. The card has only a number and no identifying information. First-time users of the program can obtain up to 40 clean needles. After each visit after that is an exchange. 1 dirty needle for 1 clean needle.
That'll be it for us tonight. Remember, your news is always on News Center's Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram pages.
And you can catch this broadcast again on MSUTV.net.
On behalf of everyone here at News Center, I'm Holly McClurkin.
And I'm Damon Huff. Have a wonderful and safe spring break.